Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
Excellent. Welcome to one of what we hope will be several events celebrating books which deal with Palestine in some manner or other. We're very fortunate to have books by two authors in this category this evening. I'm going to introduce them both. Let me explain to you that Susan Abulhawa is on her way. She was driving to the station and her car was rear-ended, so she had to deal with the police and the insurance company. She is arriving at Penn Station, or has just arrived at Penn Station, and will be here momentarily. So what we're going to do is this. I'm going to introduce our two authors. I will then introduce Saad Al-Amiri, who will be the first of our two authors presenting. I assume by then Susan will be here. You will have heard the introduction. She'll sit down, catch her breath, and talk to you about her book. Let me introduce our two authors. As you know, this is one of many events at the Center for Palestine Studies, which is now in its fifth year? Sixth year. Yes, we've had 5 years. We are in our sixth year, is organizing. We have all kinds of events involving film, involving serious academic topics, but importantly, we have a series of events which we call the bookshelf, where we're showcasing works that deal one way or another with Palestine. This evening, we're dealing with books that I think are probably easier that are more approachable for readers, and I think they're both very, very important books. The books are by, as I've said, Susan Abulhawa and Saad Al-Amiri. Let me say a little bit about Susan Abulhawa. Susan is a Jerusalemite from a family that was forced to leave Jerusalem in 1967. She's therefore the daughter of Palestinian refugees. She lives in Philadelphia, or near Philadelphia, with her daughter. She's a frequent political commentator. She is the founder of Playgrounds for Palestine, which is a children's organization dedicated to upholding the right to play for Palestinian children living under Israeli military occupation and in refugee camps, whether inside Palestine or elsewhere. She is the author, in addition to this lovely book, Between the Blue Between Sky and Water, of another a novel, Mornings in Jenin, which was an international bestseller, with the rights to the book sold in 26 languages. As I've said, after introducing the two authors, Saad will say a few words about her book and give a little presentation, and then hopefully by that time Susan will be here. Now, I have an introduction for Saad, which I'll read part of to you, and then I want to say a few words about Saad, because she's quite an extraordinary person. Saad is by now a well-known author, but as many of you perhaps do not know, who know her writings, she is also a very distinguished, prize-winning, renowned architect. She studied architecture at the American University of Beirut, at the University of Michigan, and at Edinburgh in Scotland. And she has become famous in another life as an author. Before she became an author, she did something quite remarkable with architectural skills. She could have made money, and like some architects have, being as good an architect as she is, but she decided that she would put this skill to work, and she therefore founded in 1991 something called the Riwaq Center for Architectural Conservation, which is the first institution of its kind to work on rehabilitation and protection of architectural heritage in Palestine. This is under threat. It's under threat for many reasons. It's under threat, firstly, because people don't take care of their own property, because the normal processes of urbanization and modernization and greed mean that beautiful old buildings are often allowed to deteriorate. It's under threat, secondly, because land in Palestine is the most important commodity there is. And it is under threat because seizing, taking over, legally or illegally, land has been part of the Zionist project since the very, very beginning. And so beautiful old properties like some of the ones that she and Riwaq have helped to restore are under threat from several different directions. Now, all of this would be remarkable, but Saad has done something that's very rare in the Arab world. She founded and led something, and then she voluntarily stepped down. Now, as you may have noticed, several countries in the Arab world have been convulsed because leaders refused to step down. And the joke has been made that Riwaq is the place where the Arab Spring began because a leader voluntarily stepped down. She's still deeply involved with Riwaq. She still fundraises for it, but other people run it, and she has taken her hand off the tiller, as it were. The last thing I want to say about her is this. She's written a book, the prize-winning book, Sharon and My Mother-in-Law. This is a book that's been translated into 19 languages. This is a book that was a bestseller in Italy and in France. In Italy, in 2004, it won the prestigious Viareggio Prize. She's now written the book that she's going to talk about this evening, which is entitled Golda Slept Here. So having written a book entitled Sharon and My Mother-in-Law, and a book entitled Golda Slept Here, we are expecting Rabin Stole My Breakfast, Ben-Gurion Borrowed My Pen, and so on and so forth. We expect her to write books that'll run through the whole list of Israeli prime ministers. But I'm not going to insist that she do that. Instead, I'm going to ask her to come up, and can you please give her a warm welcome?
Well, thank you. It's wonderful to have a friend introduce you, to give you a generous friend like Rashid to give you more credit than you really deserve. So thanks so much. But before I forget, because once I start talking, I never know how to stop. Before I do that, I want to thank people. I want to thank the Palestine Center for organizing this. And Dalia, thank you so much for all the work you have put. I also want to thank the publisher Bloomsbury, who have also helped in organizing this. And also I would like to thank the Institute of Middle East Understanding, who supposedly also advertised it. Book Culture, who are selling the book tonight, I want to thank them. And please, it may be, you may think that I'm here to talk about my book, but actually I am here to sell the book, just for you to notice. And I have made an agreement with the publisher that, because I convinced them to bring many copies, and I said, if we don't sell them, I will have to buy them. So please, please do save my money by taking some of them. But also, more than buying them for that sake, I want the publisher to realize that really Palestine had become a mainstream issue. You know, I lived the 70s and I knew Vietnam. If you want to show that you are progressive, you are against the war in Vietnam. And later on, if you want to show that you are progressive, you support the civil rights movement. And later on, if you want to show that you are progressive, you have to be with the African American movement. And later on, you have to be with the gay movement. And now I can claim the following. I may not look Vietnamese to you, but I could claim that I am partly African, and I could claim that I am partly, you see how gay I am, of course. And I want you to know that whoever wants in the coming year or two to show that they're progressive, they're gonna be pro-Palestine. I am convinced of it. Really, Palestine had become a mainstream. So and of course, I like to thank all the audience because it looks to me like in Amman, you know, when we went to the cinema in Jordan when I grew up, you come into the movies and you shake hands with almost everybody that is in the room. So I almost did that tonight. So Susan will join us soon, and I am really honored to be with Susan because soon at the end of our presentation, you're gonna figure out that really we have only one writer in this evening. You have a hakawati. I don't know how many of you know what a hakawati is. Hakawati is the Arabic word for storyteller. When, I don't know if you lived in a village, but normally a person, an old person arrives and they start talking, and it's middle of the night before they leave. So prepare yourself, please, for my talk. And I warned Susan today. I said, Susan, why don't you go before me? Because once I have the microphone, you're not gonna get it back. But she's not here. Anyway, I will go on. Tonight, as Rashid said, I want to talk about Golda Slept Here. But before I do that, I want to talk a little bit personally with you. Maybe not all of you know me. I am half Palestinian. My father is from Jaffa, who lost his house in Jaffa, and we became refugees in 1948. And I was born and grew up in Jordan as a refugee. And I, for a long time, actually, until 68, I thought I was Jordanian. But then the PLO came along, and that's the only time why I realized that I was Palestinian. Whether you hate Abu Ammar, Arafat or not, he's the one person that made us be proud of being, I don't want to be too proud, you know, it's just a cliche of being Palestinian. But no, anyway, my other half is Syrian. My mother is from Damascus, and you know, this book actually is the one book that ended my schizophrenia. You may not notice, but I do have a schizophrenia. Schizophrenia, not knowing whether I'm an architect or I'm a writer or I'm a Hakawati. And this book at the end, you will realize, brought these three characters into one. Now, when I studied architecture, I always try, you know, whether we study architecture or engineering or acting or medicine, we always try to think that there was a reason we became, like, if we lived again, I'm going to be an architect. No, I think it's all accidental. If you ask me, it's pure accidental. But when I try to explain why I became an architect, I always say the following, that I really lived between two worlds. That of Damascus, I have a very strong mother. I can't tell you, my father used to say, you know, there is an Arab saying, if you marry a Syrian woman, you will have long sleeps. And my father used to say, if you marry a Syrian, you never have a sleep in your whole life. And that was my mother, actually. So I grew in Damascus. And really, the city of Damascus, I don't know how many of you have been in Damascus, but it's a city that leaves its impact on you. The little alley, Souq al-Hamadiyya, the, you know, all the gold shop, all the smell of the shops there, the spice, souq al-Bzouriyya, and what have you. And also my mother came from a relatively rich family, so they had a beautiful, beautiful house in Damascus that had a courtyard, a fountain. So I grew up in that house that really left a big impact. While on the other side, my father's house was in Jaffa. And I had to sort of imagine that house. My father in Amman always told me about, you know, our house was very close to the seashore. I used to put my towel on my shoulder, cross the road, and just dip in the sea and swim every day, and then come back. And he would describe the house. He would say it was a relatively small house with a courtyard, with a lemon tree, with two floors. Your aunt lived upstairs, I lived downstairs, and so it goes. That I felt that I was really making models, architectural models, not only of my father's house in Jaffa, but also of Jaffa, a city that I never saw until later in 81. I also had to make models of Palestine from a distance. I had to imagine all of this. And many times I say that I became an architect because of that. But reality, if you want to know why I became an architect, I am dyslexic. And that's really the real reason why I became an architect. That, you know, all of this I told you is sort of a fantasy world that I like to build why I became an architect. But I can tell you the following. When I was a little kid, I used to speak like now, and my mother would look at her watch and say, Saad, for God's sake, stop it. You have been talking for 2 hours. Give us a break. And so I always knew that I like to tell a story. I like to tell a joke. But because of being dyslexic, really, I had difficulty reading. And my father was an intellectual, and every summer he would come to me and say, you know, he will get me like 5, 6 books, put them on the table at the beginning of the summer and say, Saad, every book you read, I will give you like $20. And you know, that time $20 was a lot of money. And if I have read them, I should have made like $200. By the end of the summer, I hardly made $10. So it was really very difficult. And that's why the last thing in life I thought that I would be a writer. But in 2002, actually, a miracle happened. My mother-in-law, who was 91 years old, came to live with me during the Israeli invasion of Ramallah. And she was living alone. She ended up living with me for 44 days under curfew. And I know many of you who have read Sharon and my mother-in-law You know how crazy that situation was. I always say that I ended up with two occupations, one outside the house and one inside the house. And I always say, please don't ask me which one was more difficult to deal with. But thanks to my mother-in-law, really, I became a writer. And that book, you know, I didn't write a book. I wrote emails that eventually became a book, you know, a successful book. And what amazes me is the following, and excuse me, I am not bragging since Rashid told you what I studied, but you know, like here I am. I go to AUB, study architecture, master degree in Ann Arbor, PhD in Scotland. Then I do rework, and nobody gives a damn. Nobody, really nobody knows me. And there is my mother-in-law who's 91 years old. She comes to my house, drives me crazy, and makes me write a book, and here I am going to Sydney to talk about my mother-in-law. Here at Columbia, I am to talk about Sharon and my mother-in-law. And it was an amazing success that made me think, Saad, what is it? What is it about that damn book? And by the way, I hate that book for your own information, because whatever I write, people told me, yeah, it's sort of nice, but Sharon and my mother-in-law is much better. So you really develop this hatred to your success story. And sometimes I hold Sharon and my mother-in-law and I say, what is it about you that made it in life? And you know, here I write other books, but anyway. I tried to analyze that book and I thought of the following. Maybe it was the sense of humor in it, because you know, I joked about, there was nothing sacred in that book. You know, my neighbor had a love affair who was 55, married with eight children, had an affair with a man of her age. There was one who was a collaborator, there was my terrible mother-in-law. There was also my dog, my little dog, Noura. And Noura, I tell you, I mean, my dog became more famous in the world than anybody else. You know, I had European Parliament members coming to Riwaq and asking, you know, they just walk into our office, and I used to take my dog with me. And they would come, not looking at me or anybody, can we meet Noura? We'd like to meet Noura, you know? And, you know, Noura gained the passport that I started using around on checkpoints, passing through checkpoints, using Noura's passport. So I started thinking that, what is it about this book? And I realized the following. I mean, I would like to share with you what I found. I'd better hurry before Suzanne comes, and then I become pressured.
Take your time.
No. So I realize really that one thing that we Palestinians did and Arabs did is that we never put faces and names to Palestine. It's only lately that when a Palestinian dies, we know their names. While the Israelis are just the opposite. One person dies, and rightly so, they put the name, where they're born, the story, the mother, the father, how this react, how that react. And I think part of our problem, we as a generation, and perhaps Rashid agrees with me, we were extremely political. And we made Palestine, we talked about a lost country. While we should have talked about a lost home, a lost garden, a lost tree, a lost sunset, a lost hospital, a lost school, a lost bedroom. You know, can you imagine today you leave your house, you walk out of your house. Right now, in New York, you come out of your house and you will never be able to come back to it. You miss your paintings, you miss your books, you miss your carpets, you miss your piano. And I find out that we Arabs, and Palestinians in particular, really shy away from personal losses. I can tell you the following, that we Palestinians have probably bored the world with our political loss, Palestine, as a country. And we made it very abstract. What is Palestine? You ask anybody, five words. Jerusalem, settlements, help me, Rashid. Right of return, borders, refugees. Thank you. That's about it. And then I found that really it is the personal that makes the connection with the human beings. And that's why I started when I moved into writing Golda Slept Here, this book, I must tell you, it was one of the most difficult books for me to write. Sharon, of my mother-in-law, was fun to write because it wasn't meant to be a book. Nothing to Lose But Your Life, about the Palestinian workers, was also sort of fun because it was about the workers and the others. But this is the one book where I allowed myself to be emotional, to be personal, and for the first time ever, I allowed myself to deal with the trauma of personal loss. And I am not talking about Palestine. Sometimes I say, call it a watermelon. I really don't care. When people say there was a country, there wasn't a country, you were people, I say we were watermelons on that piece of land. I don't care what you call me. All I know that we had a house there, a land there, a school there, a clinic there, we had life there. And I am not dealing with the national issues, I leave it to others. But really this house is talking about that very moment. That very moment when 850,000 Palestinians left their homeland. They were thrown out of their homeland. They were terrified out of their homeland. And that constituted in 48, dyslexia even, you know, when I used to teach history, sometimes history of architecture, and I would tell the students 2020, there Christ was born, and they would all be looking at me. So 1948, really 800,000 people were 90% of the population. 90% of your population was kicked out of their homeland, and there remains 10% that became part of what we call now 1948, or Arabs in Israel, or Israeli Arabs. And I always say we Palestinians are like car models. You know, you have 1948 Palestinians. Suzanne is 1967 Palestinians. You have 1982 Palestinians, and you have 1993, and if you're interested afterwards, I'll explain to you who these are. But anyway, the thing is, the idea of this book actually was always within any Palestinian, to lose your home. And I realized that it was so traumatic that none of our family parents actually shared that moment with us. None whatsoever. Ask people around you here. Every Palestinian will tell you, yeah, in 1948, 850. But tell me your own personal story. Do you know, when I started writing this book, I realized that really I did not know my story, my family story, my father and mother, who were in Jerusalem, in West Jerusalem. And my mother went to deposit her two child in Damascus, came back, and she found that her house was occupied by Israel, by Jewish fighters. And she had to share the house with them for 2 weeks until she, of course, had to leave the house because they wouldn't. But what I found so amazing, really, that our parents protected us. I grew up in a family in Amman, as I told you, I felt I was Jordanian. My parents never shared the trauma, what it means for my father not to have a house, not to have a job, not to have, to start from zero. And here I find myself so protected that my family never shared that moment with me, to a point where I wanted to write my story in this book. I didn't know anything about it. I had to consult with my older sisters and older cousins to put it together. And I find that just amazing, how trauma, and as my sister, who's a psychiatrist, says, sometimes with trauma, you either face it directly, or you never face it, actually, you deal with it. Now, this book actually has four characters in it. And I chose these four characters because of the way they dealt with that personal loss, with that trauma. There is myself. I want to tell you that my father's house, the one I described in Jaffa, I have no idea if it's still there. I have no idea. I never went to visit it. And the reason for that was the following.
Is that Susan, or is it my imagination?
Susan, walk in.
You made it.
much. You made it.
It's okay. I've already introduced you. And
thanks.
We let
players. And every other week or every 2 weeks, this is the scene. Huda goes. The family comes out, scream. A young boy comes out, 13 years old. Then his father follows. Then the mother follows. Then the police arrives, the Israeli police arrive. They arrest Huda. She's used to the scene. They take her. They throw her in the prison for one night. Next day, she's taken to a court. The court, she knows the judge. She's an Iraqi. She knows him by the name. He knows her by the name. And he says, Huda, for God's sake, stop bothering this Israeli family. And she says, I am bothering the Israeli family. He says, you know what? If we see you not in your garden, in the garden, if we see you in that street, we are going to deport you. Of course, they cannot, but he threatened her. And she looks at him. She says, I want to ask you a question. You know, if your father planted a lemon tree or an orange tree, wouldn't you go and pick the tree? Where have I gone wrong? And he looks at her and he says, Huda, you know what? You Arabs are always living in the past. It used to be your house. It is no more your house. You understand? And she says, it's in the past? Yeah, your problem, Arabs and Palestinians who live in the past. And Huda looks at him, at Captain, and says, yeah, for the Jews, it's okay to have a memory 2,000 years old. But when it comes to the Palestinians, we have to have 60-year amnesia. Is that right? And they go on, and I can't tell you the stories that Huda tells me about her house. So anyway, I just want to tell you one more thing. See the film. It's just a 5-minute presentation. You're going to see, I go back to the Baramki house, just for you to get to explain the supplies. You know, the Baramki house, after being an absentee, he never was able to get it. The Israelis make it a museum. Not only that, they write a letter to Gabi Baramki. By that time, Andoni, the father, has died, and ask him if he wants to be on the board of that museum. And at the beginning, really, Gabi, by the way, is like Huda. He followed. He had, when I went to interview him, he had files and files of things about his house. And, you know, they called the museum, the first name was it for Coexistence and Tolerance. And they asked for money from a German Jew who gave them the money. And actually, Gabi wrote to that German Jew telling him this story, saying, this is my house, I am here, my father is here, and I don't know how you're giving this money to them. And eventually, he gives them the money. On the opening day, Gabi decides to go to the house. And that same day, the sponsor from Germany died the same evening. I don't know, but you know, like for Gabi, it was very, very symbolic. And Gabi went after them. Eventually, they changed the name of the museum. If you go to Jerusalem today, it's called Museum at the Seam. So I'm going to stop here, actually, to give Susan some time at one point to speak. But we're going to take just 5 minutes to watch this slides, so for you to know what is it that I'm talking about. Thank you very much.
You want to show them now?
Yeah.
What do we have?
Yeah.
Can we move?
No, I just want to take this technology.
Here. The cake, come on.
Let's go over there so we can see.
Oh, yeah.
I've already introduced Susan in her absence, but I'll introduce her once again. This is the author of a celebrated book, Mornings in Jenine, which is an international bestseller with rights sold in 26 languages. This is her brand new book, The Blue Between Sky and Water. Susan.
Thanks. I just want to say, years ago, so I actually got lost on a bicycle in West Jerusalem. I was riding around, and I realized I was in West Jerusalem, and, you know, just because of the Hebrew writing on the homes, and I didn't know my way back, because when I lived in East Jerusalem, we never really went to that part of Jerusalem, and I remember just crying and crying. I looked like a crazy woman on the bike, and seeing these homes and reading this book, and then seeing that was really, really emotional. Yeah. I think that this was like the biggest heist of the century, you know, to come to this country complete with a culture, complete with homes and bank accounts and furniture and memories and trees, and claim it. It was pretty extraordinary. So I'm gonna borrow your book, and if that's okay. This is a novel, of course, but it's still historic fiction, and it does touch on the loss of home, the loss of everything, really. The novel is principally a women's story, several generations of women in one family, in a village called Beit Taras, outside of Gaza. And there are male characters in this, but it's the women who really come to the fore. There is one major male character by the name of Khaled. He's a young boy, 10 years old. And although he's flesh and blood in this novel for much of it, he also kind of becomes this ethereal, otherworldly voice, because in the 2008-2009 attack on Gaza, he goes into a state of something called locked-in syndrome, where he can perceive the world around him, but he can't interact with it. And so Khaled kind of, in his mind, his head, right there, she said. Nazmiya came to understand that the inner world of individuals formed a colored halo which only her little sister, Maryam, could see. The family spent days after that testing Maryam's ability. "Okay, tell me how I'm feeling now," her brother Mamdouh said upon returning home from a fight with the neighborhood boys. "You're red and green," Maryam replied, and turned back to whatever she was doing. Nazmiya mocked. "Red and green together means you're scared and horny." "Maryam has no idea what horny is, so I know you're lying, you horrendous, unmannered girl." Mamdouh slapped the back of Nazmiya's head and ran for cover. "You better run, boy." "I feel sorry for the poor donkey who marries you," Mamdouh said, taking cover behind the door. Nazmiya laughed, which only irritated Mamdouh more. Although Maryam's special ability waned over time, it remained one of two family secrets, and Nazmiya used it to her advantage. When the mother and sisters of a suitor came to their home to meet Nazmiya, she treated them with arrogance and sarcasm because Maryam could intuit that they found Nazmiya unworthy of their son. In the market, she shamed many a merchant who tried to cheat her. Maryam's gift was Nazmiya's secret weapon, and she forbade mention of it outside their household, just as she forbade talk of Suleiman.
Beautiful.
So, thanks.
Yeah. I would like to just one more thing. You know, I was really intrigued in reading the book and the supernatural and, you know, like the sort of magic realism also that was discussed in some of the interviews. Actually, those are the parts that I enjoyed most, I must tell you. Maybe because I come from that part of the world, and some description, really, it's amazing. You know, sometimes I carry my yellow mark, and then I find out with Suzanne's book, like every page is marked, every page, because you have an ability, you know. Really, before you came, I said you're gonna meet a writer and the Hakawati here, and your ability to describe, especially the emotions, human emotions are really amazing. And I just want you to tell me, why did you use the supernatural and the, you know, this style in sometimes, especially with Maryam, with Khalid, with Sulaiman? There are characters, not only the jinnis that mm-hmm. you talk about, but there are characters that are supernatural. Mm-hmm. What was behind it? Why?
So, I mean, as you know, I mean, at least the older generation of Palestinians, very superstitious. And I certainly grew up with, you know, these notions of jinn and stuff. I mean, my grandmother, you know, she was always worried about hased, somebody hitting you with the evil eye. And like, if you came down with a cold or something, she'd be like, oh, somebody, you know, hasadha, you know, like somebody hit her with jinxed her. Yeah. Or it's like in Italian, I think it's called the maloiks or, and when she would get mad at me, she would say jin yirkabik wala ta'alihum tasma'ish al-kalam jin yirkabik, you know, which means may a jinn possess you. I remember asking somebody as a child if the jinn are real, and I remember being terrified of being you know, possessed by a jinn. I mean, it was something I remember thinking about a lot as a child, and then thinking, oh, maybe it would be cool, you know, to get wishes. And but anyway, so I mean, it was definitely part of my childhood, and I know it's something that you know, these are conversations that people have in our society, especially in rural areas, and especially in families like mine, who were largely fallahin. They were peasant. They were mostly you know, didn't go beyond middle school, I think, for education, and so, you know, it was real. But I think the book also allows for more logical explanations, I guess. You know, one, there's, you know, Noor is a psychologist, and at one point a doctor suggests, you know, maybe it's, you know, schizophrenia, her great-grandmother or something was able to communicate with the jinn, whatever. So, I mean, it's really up to the reader to decide if it's real or not. But yeah, I mean, it's not. I mean, it's just a thread of the narrative. It's not a book of magical realism by any means. And speaking of being a Hakawati, honestly, I mean, I think you are like the queen Hakawati, Anjad. You know, I mean, like for me, you know, I agonize. Over the text, I go over it and I rewrite. But I can't imagine you do, because when I'm talking to you, when you just talk and tell a story, it's just coming out beautifully. So, I mean, yeah, you are a natural Hakawati. And I guess that, you know, Hakawati, I guess, means storyteller, but it has a different weight in Arabic, doesn't it? It's kind of a traditional thing, more of an oral
tradition. It's like poetry telling a story, mm-hmm. and you know. But the one thing that I never made a connection between being a Hakawati and a writer, but I still really, it took me for the longest time when my publisher in Italy used to tell me, you know, a writer introduces me as a writer. It's like I was looking behind my back, who's the writer? And I still feel very nervous about the writing, and that's why. Actually, when I write a book, it's my first draft, and next thing I know is like sent to the publisher. And my next book is going to be about Damascus. It's a family story. And the publisher says, listen, Saad, this time I want you to do two drafts. Sit on it and, you know, send it after a while. So I sat on it, but I didn't do any much because I really didn't know what to do with it. You know, I just simply didn't know what to do with it. And I felt every time I intervened in it, it became like less spontaneous somehow.
Wow. So that's extraordinary.
I have that difficulty where I feel that if I work on it, I don't know how to do it. Mm. But reading your book, really, I find that, for example, because English is not my mother tongue, while it is for you. I think you have two tongues, right? Show me. You're so comfortable with the language. And when I read it, you know, it's like, oh, God damn it. This is how things could be described. For me, it's like, oh, my God, where have I been? You know, so the writer in you is so amazing. And I just find it refreshing because the language is there. And the way, you know, you describe things in the same emotion appears like six times in the book, and each time you find a color, an odor, a way of describing it, and I find that really.
Yeah, except that's what you're reading is like iteration number 110, not one. Like,
no, but I'm really, really. I find it really amazing. But I just want to come back to the supernatural and magic realism. At one point, I thought, you know, when you live in a place, some people ask me, do you write fiction or nonfiction? I really don't know, because I sometimes feel our life in Palestine is fiction. I mean, it's so unreal, let's put it this way. And sometimes reading your books, I mean, really, this book is a history of Palestine. It starts from 1948, and the way you describe the Beit Daras village is so wonderful. Because really, all of us start with 1948, like we are refugees. But very few of us describe what was there before. And I liked your part when you described the village and their life there, and it made so much sense. And also about Gaza, I wanted to ask you, I know that you went to Gaza and you stayed in Gaza. Was that, the book was part of your, I mean, did many of these stories came when you were there? Or what's your relationship to Gaza? Sorry, yeah. Just a family thing.
So yeah, I mean, as you know, I'm from Jerusalem. I'm not from Gaza. But I went to Gaza several times. We built a few playgrounds there, and I was there each time. And then I was there with PALFEST, and I made a lot of friends in Gaza. And Gaza's a really special place. It's a very tortured place. It can be a dark place, and as a result, be a beautiful place. Precisely, I think, because of the darkness as well. When I was there, I wasn't thinking about, oh, I'm going to write a book here. But it was more like when I left. I think I felt like the next novel I write needs to be anchored here in Gaza. And I did a lot of research. I know I have a lot of friends from Gaza, and so they were a big part of the background and the research. I don't know if you do you know Ramzi Baroud? He's a Palestinian. Yeah, I'm sure. He's from Beit Daras, and he wrote this wonderful book called "My Father Was a Freedom Fighter," and it's set in Beit Daras, and there's a lot of background, and so I was able to get a lot of information, mm-hmm. the information about place and the families that live there, and you know how they made a living, how many schools, so I got a lot of that from Ramzi Baroud, mm-hmm. and that's the reason why I chose Beit Daras, because it, you know, but I've never been there. It's hard for me to actually go to any place in 48 territories. Yeah.
I always say, if I ever feel a stranger or a sense of estrangement, really it's in my hometown or in Jaffa or in Palestine. There is it's very troubling, because on the one hand, you're supposed to love Palestine, right? But, you know, there is this sense of being there, but it's not yours. The Arabic is all written in bad Arabic. They're making so many mistakes on the sign, you know, like Ramallah. Salim, my husband, just wrote a very interesting little article where he went to Jaffa, and then he was simply looking at the map there, you know, where it has a dot, says you are here. And in Hebrew, I don't know Hebrew, but it says you are here. And in Arabic, it says, "Anta kunta huna."
You were here. Oh my God.
That's perfect.
That is.
You were here.
Oh wow! Wow.
So no, I know. So you know, ironic. Really, it's just like. I know this feeling of being home, but feeling such a stranger, not only in 48, but also in Ramallah, Jerusalem, everywhere. I mean, it's so I don't know.
In an editorial in the newspaper Falastin, in I think 1912, I read this 40 years ago, I've used it in a book, the editor, Isa Isa, was writing about what he foresaw for Palestine. And he said that if this continues, we will be strangers in our own land. Mm. So that's exactly what the two of you have described. Mm-hmm. That was 1912. That was 103 years ago.
How precious.
He was a very far-sighted man, actually. Yeah. Well, I think that on that somber note, maybe we'll... Do you want to ask some more questions of each other? I think this is actually very interesting.
Yeah.
I'm sure that some people in the audience might have questions, but if you two want to continue, I'd be thrilled to have you do that.
I wanted to say a couple of things about Swad's writing, too, if I may. I don't know if you guys announced this when I wasn't here, but... Swad's book, Sharon and My Mother-in-Law, was just chosen for the Librarians and Archivists. Oh, okay. The Librarians and Archivists for Palestine. It's a national reading campaign. I think Hannah Mermelstein is probably in here.
She brought these along.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, so pick these up. Sharon and My Mother-in-Law was... was seminal, actually. I mean, it was amazing. And I wanted to ask you too, I mean, especially in Sharon, My Mother-in-Law, and then your second book, Murad, or Nothing to Lose But Your Life, you had a lot of references to nature and animals in particular. I think in Sharon, My Mother-in-Law, we all kind of fell in love with Noura. That's her doggie, who apparently passed away. Allah yarhamha anjat.
She's on the cover.
The American cover, actually.
Yeah. You and I have talked about being animal lovers, and so can you tell us a little bit about that and what it's like, especially in our society? Because, I mean, at least in my family, dogs are to be kept outside, and you don't have an emotional relationship with them in that way. At least, so it's always complicated for me with dogs and other animals and nature, because on the one hand there's this real love and attachment, but then on the other hand there is like a real delineation that bugs me. So
yeah, it's true, actually. Okay, I should say the following. Actually, I lived in a house that my mother in particular really, really loved animals. I mean, our garden was small. I mean, if I tell you the number of animals. First, I came to this world and my parents had Mickey. Mickey was a dog. And Mickey actually took me to school for almost 12 years. Every day, Mickey would come from the house, take me to school. Once I enter the house, she leaves. And Mickey knew exactly when I'm coming out from school. She would come, and we were called Mickey family in the neighborhood. So I really developed that attachment into animals in a great way. Well, in our little garden, I don't know, the garden was this size. We had like 2 deers. My mother had 100 some pigeons. We had a dog, of course. We had a cat with the dog. We had fish. We had turtles. We had... Aranib, rabbits. My mother, I remember she brought a monkey from Beirut. And the monkey was a crazy one, I can't tell you. I mean, monkeys, it was a real monkey. Sasha was her name. And the family got rid of her because she just drove everybody crazy. So really, Sasha scared. I don't know how many people were like, she would just act very friendly and then oops, she will just hold the kids. And the kids, like they would come to our house because of the animals, but at the same time they're but also, if you ask me about what I lost in 1967, I always relate, like we talked about houses, countries, losing your school, your hospital and what have you. And if you ask me, I lost a monkey actually in the war. And because Sasha, this crazy Sasha, there was, I don't know how many of you, there was the Dead Sea with a hotel called Casino. And every Thursday in the afternoon, especially when there is a full moon, my parents will go there for the weekend and they will take us. And there was a little zoo there for animals in the, our garden was bigger than his zoo, but in the hotel they had a zoo. And he somehow convinced my mother that we should bring Sasha into the Dead Sea, into this hotel, because they had a male monkey. And once we have the little ones, then we will divide them. I don't know how many monkeys normally comes to this world, but I was waiting for the little monkey to come home with Sasha. And then 67 happens, And then Sasha disappears from my life, and we never know whether she got pregnant or not, but really I always remember Sasha. But I think it's from my mother. You know, my mother, when she used to come and, come to visit me in Beirut, "Mom, what would you like to do?" "Is just take me to the sea, and I want to watch the sea sunset." Every single day, my mother watched the sunset. So I somehow, I don't know where it came, but I must admit, sometimes I tell you something. You know, when I look at films sometimes, or even, you know, I hate to say it, but sometimes, you know, I feel sadder about the animals somehow when an animal is killed or an animal is mistreated, more than human beings.
Because
I don't know
innocent.
Why. Because
they're
I think
helpless.
They're all innocent, and how cruel we are as human beings. But, you know, I have that attachment to animals. I cannot tell you how. Yeah. And, you know, Noura, I remember Salim, my husband, used to say, "For God's sake, talk to me as much as you talk to Noura." Yeah. So I feel really I am very privileged this way to be able to connect to nature. And I always feel that people who don't connect to nature or to animals are missing a big, big part of their life. And that's why, actually, in Nothing to Lose But Your Life, there is one chapter. Mm-hmm. I wanted to write about the separation wall, that crazy wall that the Israelis built. And I was thinking, how would I write about this concrete wall, 8 meter long, you know, high? And then I thought the only way that would make sense, actually, if I write the book from an animal's point of view, because we human beings on the Israeli and Palestinian side think that we are the only people on this planet, really. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, you know what, Saad, you're going to write a book about how this wall affected archaeological sites, architectural sites, but more, how would a deer, because we have lots of deers in Palestine, how would a deer feel? It's a place where they were running and all of a sudden there is a concrete wall. How would a turtle? Of course, again, I thought I could do the whole book, but I didn't, so I ended up just writing one.
But that was a really powerful chapter, actually. It was, brilliant. Yeah.
And that's where I thought I used, sort of fictionalized a little bit.
Should we take questions?
Yeah, let's
okay,
do it.
Okay, let's take some questions. Who has questions for either of these wonderful authors?
If you don't
maybe
have
they'd
questions.
Rather hear you two talk.
If they don't
we, can keep,
questions,
we can keep going.
We will threaten them with another story. Yeah. No, please.
No, if any, seriously, any questions, any reactions or comments? They really don't want to ask you any questions.
The first question is always the most difficult one. Yes, Nancy, what is it you want to ask me?
You
ask
can't
Suzanne.
Do that,
you wanted to ask Suzanne, you told me. You want the microphone?
No, she doesn't.
Okay.
Here's a question.
There is a question. Okay. Yeah. Stand up so they can hear you.
So my question basically is, how did you build the courage to go to Palestine for the first time? What were you feeling? And how did you finally decide, okay, now's the time to go?
Yeah.
Because I've had, so it's coming from a personal opinion where I really have the urge to go and then something just stops me.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, each one of us Palestinians who grew up in diaspora have this urge of going, but technically it's almost impossible. But also, you know, you don't have, none of my family is there. All my father's family left Jaffa. Actually, when I went to Palestine, I did not know anybody. And my mother, with whom I was living, thought I was totally crazy, you know? And she was right. I mean, she just told me, where are you? Everybody runs away from occupation and you're going to live under occupation. And, you know, she didn't like it. And at the same time, she said, "Ah, everybody's going to think that you are mukhabarat. You know, it's just like you are an agent. Why would a single woman go there?" But really, I must admit that part of it was I wanted to see how this place looked like, and then I decided the only way I could do it is write something, which is turned out to be my thesis, my architectural thesis. So I wanted a reason to go there, and that reason was to do a research on Palestinian village architecture, 19th village architecture. But that was, you know, it's just like I could have done a Palestinian, you know, a Jordanian village architecture, Lebanese, Syrian, what have you. But, you know, eventually I asked a friend to just get me a permit. And to my biggest surprise, I got it because he was connected to the Masri family. And not the Tuqan, the Masri family, and they got me a permit. And I just couldn't believe it. You know, I was holding that permit, and it's all in Hebrew, and I had no idea what it said, you know. But all I knew that this paper is going to allow me to go through. And I went. As I told you, I didn't know anybody. I went to the YMCA in Jerusalem. And the first thing I did is go, guess where? In Jerusalem. No, not to the Dome of the Rock. Not to Al-Haram al-Sharif.
To Rijman.
Not to the Holy Sepulchre. None of the above. I went to Zalatimo Suites.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Because I remember before 67, that's where my father, as I told you, with the, you know, Dead Sea, after Dead Sea, we went to Jerusalem. And there is this Zalatimo shop, for those of you who know the old city. It's a little place that does sort of, you know, mtabba, which is like a crepe. And for a little girl, I remember the most thing that intrigued me is the mtabba, because he had like a pizza, you know, and he would just throw it like this. And the only memory I had of Jerusalem is that dough going like this and thrown and then syrup on it and then cheese on it. And that was my dream, you know. So I went and I had my, and I must tell you, it was very lonely. It was very lonely, very strange. And I was waiting for Bir Zeit University to open, you know, so I could have a niche in which I will start teaching. And that's when Salim Temari appeared, my husband, and you knew it was a weak point, so chuck, you know. So I ended up falling in love with a man, ending up marrying, and slowly it became home. But I must tell you, it was difficult, still sometimes difficult, and I want to share with you this just one little detail. Because I grew up as a Palestinian abroad with a Syrian mother, really the Arab world was my place. I felt at home in Amman, I felt at home in Damascus, I felt at home in Beirut, I felt at home in Cairo where my father worked for a little bit. So for me, the Arab world was the place, you know, the music, Umm Kulthum, Sabah, Fairouz, name it. And to my biggest surprise was when I went to Palestine, how closed it is. And how, you know, like you meet a whole generation that have no idea how a Lebanese looks like. And I remember a story. I had a student who was active with the Popular Front, and he was put in prison. And eventually he was given the choice of staying in prison or being deported. He opted for being deported. Amin, if you know him. And Amin went to Amsterdam, and I happened to be in, you know Amin? Yeah. And I happened to be in Amsterdam. I called my students, let's go out for a drink and what have you. And I go there, and Amin is so happy in Amsterdam. And of course, he says, it's a great city. And you know, I'm talking a young man who's 19, 20. Of course, it's a great city. I mean, if you have hash and you go to the red district and what have you, it's a great city, of course. And then he looks at me, he says, you know, Saad, I now have an Iraqi friend. I now have a Yemeni friend. I now have an Egypt. And I was looking at him and say, what is he talking about? Only then it dawned on me that the Palestinians living in Gaza and the West Bank, really they have no connection with the Arab world. And for me, that is the biggest tragedy. So when you live abroad, you come to Palestine and, you know, expect to be a stranger in your hometown. I must tell you that. I mean, be prepared to be a stranger. But at the same time, you know, you connect. The place is beautiful. It was beautiful. It's changing.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Ah, so you have the house here.
Yeah, but you said something that really interested me. I was born and raised in the States, and so of course I love to declare that I'm Palestinian. I always do. I'm so proud of it. When I'm with my mom and she's asked, "Where are you from?" she'll often respond, "I'm Jordanian." And I always thought that that was her trying to not be political. But you said something that really shifted that for me, because you relate to that as well. You said that you didn't know you were Palestinian. You knew you were, but you felt like a Jordanian until whatever age. Can you talk a little bit more about
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
I mean, hopefully this is insightful to everyone else, too.
Yeah, well... First of all, Amman, you know, is a town that, you know, existed, of course, in the Roman period and what have you, but really became a city, basically, in 48 as the influx of the Palestinian refugees. Amman actually is an interesting place because with every war it nourished, you know what I mean, in 1948, 67, then the Lebanese war, then the Iraqi war, and now with the Syrian war. So it's a town that has always shifted in population. But feeling Jordanian is the following, because we Palestinians, you know, when our parents left, really they were just trying to make it. It's like the new immigrants in America. You want to be more American than the Americans, you know, the older generation Americans, and you want to put the American flag in front of your house and, you know, look at the Arabs, one generation and they lose the language. So I think the Palestinians, I remember, for example, that Palestinian had a negative connotation because it only meant that you were refugee, and it was true. I mean, most of them were refugees. So parents were trying very hard to make a living, so also they wanted to assimilate. And in Jordan, Jordan, I must say, in spite of the fact that I you know, objected a great deal to the Jordanian regime and what have you, but Jordan was one of the countries that gave the Palestinians a passport and did not distinguish until later, maybe, between Palestinians. I mean, they just gave us passport. So anyway, my father, even though he talked, I knew I was Palestinian, but it wasn't an issue because the whole issue was making a living. And only in 68, when the PLO and Arafat started the PLO movement, and I remember there were demonstrations in the street, I was in a government school, and every beginning of this school, the year, the teacher would come in, who is a Palestinian also, and she would ask, who is not Jordanian? And the Yemeni will stand there, and Iraqi will stand there, a Syrian, you know, just for the, because the tuition was different. And I remember in 68, I stood up. And the teacher looked at me, she knew me like for 17 years, 16 years. It's like, what happened to you? Mm-hmm. It's like, I'm not Jordanian, what are you? I am Palestinian. And she looks at me and she says, okay, sit down, because you're gonna be in trouble soon, you know? And it's true, I mean, 2 weeks later, the PLO calls on a demonstration. And we organize all the students and on the university, on the school, and it's like we're going to take part in that demonstration. Yes, yes, yes. And then we tell, you know, when I come out, you, or the whole class. We had like each class, we had one leader that when I run, the whole class will run after me. And sure enough, 11 o'clock came, and I looked around, and I came out, and I ran, and then I ran, and I ran, and I looked behind, and there were hardly five of us. It turns out the teachers knew, the Mudira, they were all Palestinians, by the way. So your mom also, really, and there are people who were never political also in Jordan, Palestinians, who don't want to interfere. My sister happened to be like with the PLO, Fateh, and then Democrat, and what have you. And she was the one who made me aware more, because she joined, she went to Lebanon, and then I went to Lebanon. But I, my own brother, actually, I tell you a funny story. Rashid and I were in the negotiation team in Washington at one point in this, you know,
1991 to 93.
Yeah, the negotiations.
The negotiations.
I was on the Palestinian delegation, and my brother, who worked in the Jordanian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, was on the Jordanian delegation. And my sister was outside demonstrating against both of us.
That's great. That's great.
Any more questions? I think we can take, why don't we take those two?
Well,
and that'll
true.
Be it, okay?
I swear
so,
to God.
Yes.
So my mother's Palestinian, my father is white. And
your mother is?
My mother's Palestinian, she's from Guinea. And my father is Caucasian.
Ah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm actually a little surprised to hear that, because I think I am and I'm not. I think that there's a tendency, I think, for those of us who live outside to kind of romanticize Palestine, and I really try not to do that a lot. I think there's an element of what you're saying, partly because I think when people are under so much external pressure, they are more cohesive. And I mean, I've definitely noticed that in places like Jenin. It differs, like Jenin versus Jerusalem. Jerusalemites have a lot more freedom, like my family. And my family is very, you know, can be very judgmental, this or that. Is, you know, Ada Ghazawi, this is a Khalili. And, you know, and I mean, even amongst ourselves, there are distinctions and stuff. But then you go to places in Gaza, like where there is so much, life is so difficult, and you do find more human connections, and all the various barriers do fall apart. But I personally don't feel like there is this, you know, magical aura about being Palestinian that makes us sort of exceptional. I think that we are a battered, traumatized, beautiful, ancient society with so many different facets, a lot of prejudices, a lot of acceptances, and we're just not one thing. And that's what I always try to convey. Like when I was in Norway recently for the Norwegian translation of this book, and on two different occasions in two different cities, I got a comment from journalists or a question that how are there so many different Arab personalities? Because the comment was that these women are all so different, and I thought, you know, that's incredible, you know, but I think ultimately I think that's how the world views our society, as in very simplistic terms, and I think especially in Western imaginations, we are either victims or we are aggressors, terrorists, and so forth. The women are always very pious, and I think you know, these journalists were kind of shocked to see these women who defy the stereotypes and so forth. So I think it's just important not to describe us as one thing, you know. There's truth to what you're saying, but I don't think it describes all of Palestinian society. I don't know how you feel about that, but I think we're huge, you know. I mean, our society spans the full spectrum of humanity, period. Yeah.
I think one thing you will find, though, at least I find this, is that the fact that it's such a shattered and displaced society,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
means that when you are when people talk to you and they realize that you are Palestinian, not apparent from the way we dress, for example, or whatever, our haircuts or our shoes, whatever, the second or third question will be, where are you from?
Yeah, when Aradik.
Intimin Utz, Intimin Yefa, and so on, or this village or this town. And that is a connection. You have that in Lebanon too, actually.
Yeah.
But the Lebanese, they don't need to ask. They know from your accent, your name, exactly where you're from. Palestinian society is so shattered that you have to ask, because somebody can be coming with a white father and a haircut like yours, or dressed like a professor like me, and it's not immediately apparent where you're from or who you are.
Right, right.
But I find that is just automatic anywhere you go.
Yeah,
that's Intimin Fein.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's not, do you come from Toledo?
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know,
yeah,
or
yeah.
Chile or whatever it may be.
Yeah, and it is an immediate connection. I agree.
Yeah.
But especially for those of us who are on the outside in the diaspora. Yeah.
Maybe one more question. Yes, this gentleman here. You. No. Oh, sorry. Hannah, I'm sorry. I didn't see you.
Thank you. I'm flattered. Thank you so much. No, no, I love it. It's my first baby. It's just like I want to come back to that success, and I haven't been able to do. Thank you.
Great. On that note,
I want to say, can I just say something?
Yeah. Of course. Go ahead.
I just want to say something briefly, just a closing thought. I think oftentimes I feel like everything has been taken from us, and what we have left are our stories and our voice. And I feel very protective and possessive of our narrative, and I oftentimes am intellectually aggressive when I feel like people step into this collective wound that we have and presume to narrate from our wound, because it is, you know, in many ways, this collective trauma is the thing, with all its stories and all its words, is the thing that still binds us. It's the thing that still grounds us in who we are. And so when you are reading about Palestine, when you're reading fiction or nonfiction about Palestine, I hope it's by Palestinians. Because for so many years, until really recently, who we are, so everybody but Palestinians has presumed to speak for and about Palestinians. And we now, the past 20 years or so, there's been this amazing sort of emergence of so many Palestinian writers and artists and cultural workers who are presenting Palestinian realities and as consumers of literature, I hope that at least on this subject, you would go, you know, to members of that culture who write about their culture.
Nice. What Susan is talking about is what the namesake for whom the chair I have the honor to hold described as permission to narrate.
Yeah.
Palestinians never had the permission to narrate. Everybody else told their story. Most cases mistold their story or told another story and said that's the only story.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I would encourage you to consume films, go to plays, read novels, read nonfiction, fiction.
Buy the book.
And buy the books. Thank you very much.
Sign.
I want you to sign.
If you want your book signed, come here.